So this is an outline of what I'll be talking about today, and I want to make a few things kind of clear to you. The main thrust of what I'm trying to discuss is basically an area of applied math that is a growth area. The emphasis here is not going to be on the mathematics. If I end up teaching any mathematics, those are food. So the emphasis is going to be on the applications and potential job opportunity, or maybe I should say career opportunity for you. So we have a lot of opportunities going on here, and this is going to be, the title of the talk's not up there, but the title of the talk was chaos and fractals in biology. And so I want to hone in on a couple of biological examples, one that involves chaos and one that involves fractals. In the course of doing that, I'm going to talk about what it means for something to be chaotic, and what it means, aside from the top of my desk, there's better definitions than just go look at my desk kind of definitions.
Kind of a creative mind.
Yeah, and what it means for something to be fractal. So we'll discuss that a little bit on the way. Some of you guys are pure mathematicians, and before we get further into this, I want to tell you right at the beginning that the mathematics behind fractals and chaos, which are related topics, is very, very deep mathematics. And the bibliography that I handed you, there's a route to get from where you are today, most of you, to that level of mathematics. But it's deep mathematics. It's not easy mathematics, but that's what makes it fun. But I want to start just by illustrating what kind of thing is going on here. So there's a man, and I have his name. He's one of hundreds of thousands of men. His name is Richard Shane. He's 56 years old. 34 years before he was 56, at the age of 22, he's talking on the phone to a friend of his, and he started feeling a little weird. And then he lost consciousness. He blacked out. And from that point on, for the next 30-odd years of his life, he had 2 to 5 seizures every week. And they were epileptic seizures. Epileptic seizures are basically storms, electrical storms in your brain. And this afflicts about 3 million people in the United States. And it's very, very difficult to control. There hasn't been much progress made for 30 or 40 years in this area of medicine. Epilepsy is devastating. Think about it. You don't know when you're going to black out. You don't know when you're going to lose consciousness. Can't drive a car. If you drive a car, you can crash and burn quite easily at any time. He had an infant son. He couldn't give his infant son a bath because if he did, and he happened to have a seizure at that time, the infant son could drown. Think of all the things in your life that you could not do if you had a seizure at any minute. You couldn't do what I'm doing right now. You couldn't stand up in front of a group and talk. Because you know, I might be on the floor in the next nanosecond. So this is what he went through. Now, is there medication? Yeah, there's all kinds of medication. 30 or 40 medications are used for epilepsy treatment. The problem is, in 30% of the cases, they don't work at all. They're not effective. It's probably one of the rare diseases where there's not much you can do that's really effective. And so, ultimately, what happened to Mr. Shane is, after all of these decades of suffering, they finally located a spot in his brain where this was originating from. And that took decades to do. That itself was hard to do. When they located the spot, he went through surgery, and that seems to have fixed it. The problem there is there's many types of epilepsy. Some of them are localized to one spot in the brain. But even if it is, they have trouble finding it. And other types of epilepsy are more diffuse. They spread throughout the brain. Then this doesn't work. Scientific American, after ending up doing this talk, this is timely actually, last month, Scientific American, April 2017, has an article entitled The Epilepsy Dilemma. This is a real dilemma. And it's something that is quite current and quite ongoing. Now, what I propose and what has been proposed before is that math can maybe help with this. Math in general, chaos theory specifically, can maybe help with this. So after we have a little detour and talk about the importance of biomathematics, I'm using the term biomathematics, by the way, loosely. Sometimes this is called mathematical biology. Sometimes this is called computational biology. Goes by lots of names, but basically I'll call it biomathematics. And there's a communication problem involved in this. So that's the next thing I want to talk about. And there was another article, not quite as recent, but this article drew my attention too. In the United States, there's two large math societies. One's called the AMS for the American Mathematical Society. The other one is called MAA, for Mathematical Association of America. Every month, the AMS publish their notices. And this is from November 2015. The article's entitled, long article, goes on for some pages. It's entitled, Mathematical Biology is Good for Mathematics. It's good for you, too. It talks about the growth industry that has become biomathematics in this country. And there's a couple of interesting things about this. Biology is very, very hard to model compared to physical systems or physical systems from engineering or physics. It's extremely difficult to model. And if you think about this, there's some pretty good reasons for this. One is that the simplest biological entity you can imagine is vastly more complicated than any physical machine that exists, or any physical item that exists in the universe. Vastly more complicated. Orders of magnitude more complicated. So you want to model this, you got quite a job on your hands. You got a lot of difficulty. But you also need to get a job, and you need to keep a job, and you want a career. When I started studying this in grad school, this was a total backwater to study biomathematics. People laugh at you. It was a total backwater. And then slowly, kind of caught on. In the last 25 years or so, it's growing into, from a little backwater of mathematics, it's growing into one of the major areas of applied mathematics in the world. It's growing immensely. And one of the reasons for that is because biology has exploded in the past 25 years or so also. So for example, there is an annual meeting of neuroscientists. Now, neuroscience is just one piece of biology. The annual meeting in neuroscience alone draws 30,000 attendees each year. 30,000 attendees in neuroscience. That's not counting all the other areas of biology, just in neuroscience. To put that in perspective, every January there's a joint math meeting between the AMS and the MAA and something called SIAM, which stands for the Society of Applied Mathematics. I'm leaving out one. Society of Industrial and Applied Mathematics. That group, which is many of the mathematicians in this country, has about 5,000 attendees. So the neuroscientists alone are six times as many as all of mathematics at these meetings. And so this is an example of the growth of biology over the past 20 or 25 years. And most biologists don't know much math. When I first started talking to biologists, most of them had not even had a semester of calculus. Their math education was pre-calculus. Now, they have to have calculus, but usually they have to have single variable calculus. Some schools might require multivariable calculus, 5C. Many schools don't. And most schools certainly don't require differential equations, which has a certain irony to it, because most biological models are differential equations. Okay? And very, very few biologists know differential equations. So they have a need for mathematicians. They have a huge need for mathematicians. But there is a problem. The problem is that biologists look down on mathematicians. Less so now than 30 years ago or 25 years ago, but they still do. There's huge communication problems. One of the things that attracted me to the field is that if you talk to a biologist, they're very hostile. At least in the day that I talked to biologists, they were very hostile. And here's the problem. The problem is that maybe some of you have gone, I know some of you are taking differential equations, maybe sometimes, you know, at least one student is in Phi B, but making a math model is very, very hard. It's like a word problem from hell. It's like crazy, rabid word problems. Because if you make a math model, you're walking this tightrope. The tightrope is that if you make the model too simple, you're leaving out too much of the complexity of what you're modeling. But if you put in too much in the model, it's intractable. You can't solve it. It might be so intractable that your computer geeks can't solve it either. This happens, especially in biology. Especially in biology. And then you have these biologists who don't know much about math, they don't understand math, they don't understand the modeling process clearly, and they're going to say to you, you don't get it. This model's garbage. You're leaving out all of this messy stuff. You're leaving out all this detail. And the truth is, they're both right. The mathematicians and the biologists are both right. A mathematical model, if it's a good one and if it works, can do a lot for biologists. It has a lot of predictive power. It can be used in lots of different contexts. It's a wonderful thing. But you need communication. You need to convince the biologist that this is the case. And you need to convince them that you're not a total idiot. You know that they're dealing with a lot of messy stuff. They're dealing with a lot of exceptions. But mathematicians have a ton of stuff to contribute. Now, in the past 10 or 15 years, there's a softening on the part of biologists towards mathematicians. I found myself a couple years back as a patient at City of Hope. And I lived there for over a month, so I got to know City of Hope pretty well. There's a department at City of Hope called Mathematical Oncology. Whole department staffed by mathematicians, applied mathematicians. Things like that would have been unheard of couple decades back. I think John can maybe attest to
absolutely some of this money.
It would have been unheard of a couple decades back. Hey, Nick. Okay? Now, there's something else that happens. With biology being much more complicated than physics, and with biology exploding where new data is discovered and unearthed every single day, we have this two-way communication between mathematics and biology. Math models are using things, well, I already mentioned ODEs, ordinary differential equations. Also, PDEs, partial differential equations, are used in math. But graph theory, topology, chaos theory, obviously, I'm going to be talking about that. Fractal geometry, combinatorics, these are all areas of math that are used in biology, medicine, and different biological sciences. But I said it was a two-way street. It works in the other direction as well. Biology has helped to develop some mathematics over the years. And one example of this is 1952 Nobel Prize went to two men, Hodgkin and Huxley. Hodgkin and Huxley developed an equation, a set of equations actually, to talk about how nerve cells, neurons, behave, how axons and dendrites work, how they fire, and some of the mathematical things going on with neurons. And they got the 1952 Nobel Prize for their work. But the problem was, their four differential equations, they weren't ordinary differential equations, they were PDEs. They were partial differential equations, four of them coupled together, highly nonlinear, and they made a model. The model could be solved on computers circa 1952, but in a very primitive fashion. And that PDE, set of PDEs to this day is pretty intractable. And so ever since then, people have been working on other models to talk about the nervous system. And along with that, something that happened even early, well, about the same time, slightly earlier, Alan Turing, famous for all this stuff with computer science, also was an early biomathematician. And Alan Turing did something in an area called morphogenesis. He was talking about how embryos develop. And basically, he was helping to answer the question, how did the leopard get its spots? His work in morphogenesis tackled questions like that. Why do leopards look like they do? Why do zebras look like they do? And this fed from a biological question into new mathematics. we have areas in mathematics called reaction diffusion equations. They exist because of biology, because of what Alan Turing and Hodgkin and Huxley did in biology. That has actually changed mathematics. So it's a two-way street for us. And as the article in the AMS points out, there's a very, very robust and growing job market for biomathematicians. There is a huge lack of biomathematicians. Okay? Now, one of the other things, if you're in my class, you hear this from me, sometimes almost jokingly, but, you know, most of the math you learn here, PCC, is from the 18th century and 19th century, isn't it? Okay? You know, in my 55 class, we're talking about the method of Frobenius. Wow, hot news, 19th century, mid-19th century. This is hot news for us. And it kind of relatively is, because compared to Newton and Leibniz and those boys, this is pretty recent stuff, you know, mid-1800s. That's because what we learn, mainly in differential equations and in calculus, was born from classical physics. Okay? Mainly it's coming from classical physics. So it's dealing with science that existed in the 1800s and the 1700s. And you kind of have to learn that before you can learn much else. But let's think about biomathematics for a second. The examples I'm going to give will use chaos theory and fractal geometry. That's 20th century mathematics, and it's continuing into the 21st century. So this is way more modern mathematics. And because of that, it's harder mathematics. There are many, many layers you can talk about these things. Chaos had something happen to it in the 1980s that was kind of a double-edged sword. This man named James Gleick wrote a book called Chaos, and the book went nuts. We would say it went viral, but that's before things went viral. It became a huge bestseller, sold millions of copies, still does, it's in the library. And James Gleick wasn't a scientist, wasn't a mathematician, but he was a very smart science journalist. And he wrote a wonderful book, and he was very careful about talking to a lot of mathematicians. And he got all his I's dotted and his T's crossed, and he wrote a good book that stood up to, there's a lot of people who wanted to say the book was junk and garbage and pop science, but they really couldn't. It's still cited, it's one of the things I put in the bibliography that I handed you. And he started this explosion of chaos theory, and it reached the popular consciousness. Sure, you were there?
Oh, yeah.
You were there, John?
I know everything he's saying is true.
Okay. Yeah, you tell me if I'm lying. Okay. So what happened was everybody and his brother and sister knew about chaos theory at this level at least. And everyone was saying, yeah, this is an example of chaos. All the sociologists, psychologists, everyone. Chaos was everywhere. And then what happened was there was a backlash against that because it was misused. So the book was a dual-edged sword. It made chaos pretty famous, but it also allowed, you know, any charlatan or fly-by-night person, you go over to, you know, Jack in the Box, first guy you see eating a burger at Jack in the Box, and you all about chaos theory. And so it had this backlash against it. But it is very solid, real mathematics. Both chaos theory and fractal geometry, which are intimately related, they are based on an area of mathematics called measure theory. Now, measure theory measures things in ways that we're not normally used to. And they also lead to integrals that are quite a bit different than the Riemann integral that you grew up with. They use something called Lebesgue integration and measure theory. Now, normally this is taught in graduate school. And so the mathematics behind chaos and fractals is very, very deep stuff. So if you read anything to the contrary, that's wrong. Okay? So, what about this chaos, and what can I say about it? What does this really mean? I've talked about the importance of biomathematics. I want to get to my example on epilepsy, and I'm taking a lot of time. I was worried I wouldn't have enough to say, but now I'm worried on the other direction. Who's the guy who's going to physics lecture at 7? Taylor?
Yeah.
We'll make it.
Okay.
But let me show you something else. I hope this works. I'm doing this in kind of a primitive fashion. I email all this stuff to myself. I'm not a big PowerPoint guy. So if I screw this up, just bear with me for a minute or two, if you would. Okay? Oh, man. Let's see what happens. Let's see what comes up. Okay. This will work. So I email all this stuff to me. And let me bring up one of the things that I want to show you here. So before I do a definition of chaos, I want to show you this. It's been a basis. No, I don't want to show you that. I lied. Hang on a second. Technical problems. Instead, this is what I want to show you. Okay. I hope you can see the colors in here. But I want to show you kind of an example of where chaos is coming from and some of the things about chaos that are kind of interesting. So I have a few pictures to show you here. So before I define chaos, I want to talk to you about where this was born. There was a French mathematician, Henri Poincaré, who had a glimmer of chaos back in the late 1800s, so right around the turn of the century, 1900s. But he didn't have a computer. It didn't exist. So his glimmer was just that, a glimmer. But it was a very far-seeing mathematician. He never lived to really see this come to fruition. But there was another person who was named Edward Lawrence, and all the references to most of these people, I might have left off Edward Lawrence, but he was an atmospheric scientist, meteorologist. But before he was a meteorologist, he got a degree in math. And so he was a meteorologist who knew a ton of math, more than the average meteorologist would do. And this was trying to work with a part of weather prediction. It was basically convection layers of heat and so forth. And the existing models for this, and this is circa 1963, and the existing models for this were partial differential equations. And again, partial differential equations are notoriously hard. Today, 2017, in 1963, they were impossibly hard almost. And so he wanted to kind of get a simpler version of these partial differential equations, which were so intractable. And so he came up with a set of ordinary differential equations, and it's a system of ordinary differential equations where we have three differential equations coupled together. So the good news is that I'm not going to pursue the math here too much at all, and I was afraid that we'd get bogged down in this. I don't want to do that. But here are the differential equations. Now, the dot above, like dx with a dot above it, standard notation for the derivative with respect to time. So think of this x dot as dx dt. So these are our ordinary differential equations. And here they are. There's three of them. So it's a three-dimensional system. And three-dimensional systems are where chaos starts to appear. And so here are the differential equations. Now, these differential equations are nonlinear. There's parameters in this thing. The sigma and the r and the b are parameters. R, for example, is a Reynolds number. If you study physics, you probably have seen that before. But these differential equations are nonlinear. They're nonlinear because of that right there and that right there. That's what makes them nonlinear differential equations. And so this was his scaled-down, simplified version of, we hope, what would model some atmospheric conditions. Now, in the process of doing this, he encountered something very unusual indeed. He encountered chaos. This is a chaotic system. So I want to give you a feel for what it means kind of visually and verbally before we get into a mathematical definition of it. And even then, it's kind of a, I don't want to say dumbed down, but it's a simplified mathematical definition because, again, this involves graduate level math generally. So what you're looking at, if you can see it, see that little red dot right there? right there. That's at time zero. And what's happened is, this is called phase space. Basically what he's doing is he's plotting not, you could plot a solution to one of these differential equations by plotting x versus t. And you could plot a solution y versus t and z versus t. But that's not what he's doing. Instead, he's plotting x versus y versus z on these three coordinate systems. So that's what he's plotting. We call it phase space. And when he plotted that, that little red dot right here represents 10,000 initial conditions that were as close together as he could possibly make them. Now, if a system behaves in a non-chaotic way, if you have initial conditions that are that close together, you would expect that as time unfolds, they would stay close together. Maybe not exactly that close together, but pretty close together. He has 10,000 of these. But look what happens. The red denotes the initial conditions. Now look at them. These conditions were infinitesimally close together at the beginning. And yet, they certainly aren't now. And in chaos theory, this is one of the criteria of chaos theory, or the definition of chaos. We call this kind of situation a sensitive dependence on initial conditions. Sure is, isn't it? Because it's really spread out. And so he noticed this. But there's another thing that he noticed too that was really weird. Notice the shape. How many of you guys have heard of the butterfly effect? Anyone heard of the butterfly effect? That name comes from that shape. This is called a Lorentz attractor. And it exhibits the butterfly effect. Now, this is said in various ways. You know, butterfly flaps its wings in somewhere on the East Coast, and it causes a typhoon in Japan. And there's literally some truth to a statement like that. Because weather is a chaotic system. But he noticed this, and the other thing he noticed is that, and this you can't really see from the picture, but the other couple things he noticed is that this thing is aperiodic. That means there are no periods in here. Nothing is repeated. Now, we can't see it, or ice can't resolve it, the picture can't resolve it, but basically, no two trajectories will ever merge or cross each other. At all. But they're also confined to a very relatively small space. And this is the other thing that is interesting about these. So it's aperiodic, it has a sensitive dependence on initial conditions, and it's a deterministic system. And this is the other hallmark of chaos. And this is also really weird. Chaos behaves in a way that looks extremely random, like there's some kind of element of probability involved. But there's not. It's 100% deterministic. So it's a deterministic system, it's aperiodic, and it's sensibly dependent on initial conditions. And this is what Lorentz discovered in his calculation. Now let me fumble around with this and bring up what I was trying to show you, what I showed you prematurely before. So let me bring up another picture that will show me, again, I apologize for this roundabout way. I got to learn more about PowerPoint. So, I think I showed you this prematurely, but let me bring up this one now. Okay. Here's one definition of chaos. There's no one totally 100% accepted definition of chaos in the world. But the definition that's most commonly accepted is one that's due to Bob Devanian from Boston University. And he's got two hits in the bibliography there that I gave you. But his definition definitely depends on a knowledge of at least real analysis, usually measure theory also. So this is what I mentioned, and this is kind of the way of writing it down. So chaos, that one line definition of chaos, and then I need to scroll up, I'm missing some of the definition. Then we'll take a closer look at this. So, chaos is an aperiodic long-term behavior in a deterministic system that exhibits sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So again, aperiodic means that there exist trajectories which do not settle down to fixed points or periodic orbits as t approaches infinity. It's deterministic, which means there is no random element to it or noisy inputs on the parameters. Totally deterministic system. And it has, as we've seen, a sensitive dependence on initial conditions. So that nearby trajectories, initial conditions, separate exponentially fast. And that means something that is going to be related to this example that I'm going to be talking about in epilepsy. We have something, there's something called a Lyapunov exponent. Spelled wrong on my printout, I'm just saying there shouldn't be an N there. It's spelled also two ways. There's a Russian mathematician who lived from 1857 to 1918. And it's sometimes spelled, if you're Googling any of this business, it's sometimes spelled L-Y-A, and the rest of it's the same. And there's no N in either case. But Lyapunov came up with various things in mathematics. He worked in a lot of areas in mathematics. And he came up with something called Lyapunov numbers, and related to that, this idea of Lyapunov exponent. Now, he didn't know about chaos. He predated that. He was using this stuff in another context. But it turns out, I'll talk a little bit about this Lyapunov exponent a little later. But it turns out, this is notoriously hard to compute. Even if you have a closed form formula and you're trying to compute it, Lyapunov exponent, it's very tough. The book by Strogatz kind of tells you a little bit about how to do it, a little bit. And if you're computing it from experimental data, like you would if you're looking at cases of epilepsy, it's even harder to compute. It's a big deal computing it. But if we can compute this, and we can now, then what we're looking for is this exponent being positive. If the exponent is positive, that's the hallmark of that part of chaos. So a positive Lyapunov exponent is kind of the gold standard today for figuring out if you have chaos or not. Okay? Can I get rid of some of this? You guys okay?